when I came to the village and seeing the situation where mothers and, you know, children and adults were going through, I knew that there's nothing will change their life but education.
They don't see it. They don't see it, what we are struggling with, you know, to improve our status of poverty, to improve education, to improve health.
When I was 13, like you, I never learned anything yet. When I was 14, I started A, B, C, D. My finger at those days was my pencil. And the dirt was the paper. It took me 8 years to finish eighth grade.
In 2010, we started raising money, and I came back in 2010, and I had a meeting in the trees there with the village chief and community, and said, we're going to come back and we are going to build a school.
South Sudan is rising from the ashes like a phoenix, and this school, this place, is where it's happening.
It's early January 2013. Sebastian Maroundit, a former refugee from South Sudan, is on his annual trek back to his homeland from Rochester, New York.
I have no fear. I used to back in 2007. Because I was worried maybe Sudan will go back to conflict between North and South. But since South Sudan became an independent state, independent country in Africa, I have no fear.
When he began making those trips in 2007, it had been nearly 20 years since Maroundit returned to his village, Mayanabun, in Warb State. It's where he was separated from his family back in 1988, when his village was attacked by a militia group. Maroundit was 9 years old.
Government authority on
development. In 2005, the government of Sudan and the Sudan People's Liberation Movement, a political party in the south, signed a comprehensive peace agreement called the CPA. The move ended a decades-long civil war. A key component of the CPA was a referendum, a vote by the people of southern Sudan to determine whether they wanted to remain a part of Sudan or become an independent nation.
The war have created this situation in which no southerner, even an educated villager, know what's going on now. They know that this referendum is not like voting for leader, but voting for your own life and your children's life.
Those who voted for separation in southern Sudan were...
In January 2011, more than 99% of the people in the south voted for independence from the north. And on July 9th, 2011, the largest country in Africa split into two nations, the Republic of Sudan and the Republic of South Sudan. But the world's newest nation has had its work cut out for it. In December 2013, South Sudan President Salva Kiir accused his former vice president of an attempted coup. The result, a power struggle between those faithful to Kiir and those loyal to former deputy Riek Machar. Violence spiraled as fighting reportedly killed thousands of civilians and displaced hundreds of thousands from their homes. The conflict continued throughout the early months of 2014, even after a ceasefire. And continued tension between the north and south has diminished oil production. That's a sector the south relies on heavily. Infrastructure is lacking, and the nation has a wealth of agricultural assets that have gone untapped. An estimated 80% of the people in South Sudan are unable to read and write. However, Maroundit says that can all change. According to him, there's one thing that can turn it all around, creating more opportunities to get an education.
Having a school in the village will help to transform the life of the people in the village in a decade or two. They can have doctors, they can have nurses, they can have educators, something that will change that community to have a future and hope.